Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh, and welcome back to our hadith class. We are doing the kitab known as Riyaadhus Saaliheen of Imam al-Nawawi rahimahullah, and we are still busy with the chapter regarding truthfulness. So we've got two ahadith only to complete this chapter, so without further delay, let us begin. Bismillahi walhamdulillahi wa salatu wa salamu ala rasulillahi wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa man wala. So we are doing the 58th hadith, which is al-hadith al-khamis, the fifth hadith in this chapter. An Abi Hurairah radiyallahu anhu qala, qala rasulullahi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, ghaza nabiyyu min al-anbiya'i salawatullahi wa salamuhu alayhim. Hadhrat Abu Hurairah radiyallahu anhu, he said that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that a Nabi from the Anbiya alayhi musallatu wa salam, he had gone out in jihad, ghazwa. So he had gone out in jihad with his people. فَقَالَ لِقَوْمِهِ, so he told his people, okay, first point that I want to point out over here is Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam did not make mention of the name of this Nabi. However, the Fuqaha al-Muhadithin, they have mentioned that the name of this Nabi was Hadhrat Yoosha ibn Nun alayhi salam. He was the nephew of Hadhrat Musa alayhi salam, known as Joshua for the Christians. So, you know, when Hadhrat Musa alayhi salam had gone out to meet Hadhrat Khidr, and the youngster that was with him was Hadhrat Yoosha. So this is Hadhrat Yoosha. This is now obviously speaking after Hadhrat Musa alayhi salam had passed away. Hadhrat Harun alayhi salam had passed away, and he was the Nabi of the time, and Bani Israel also had jihad as well. So Hadhrat Yusha alayhi salam, together with Bani Israel, they had gone out in jihad. فَقَالَ لِقَوْمِهِ, so he told his people, لَا يَتْبَعَنِي رَجُلٌ مَلَكَ بُضْعَ مْرَأَةٍ وَهُوَ يُرِيدُ أَن يَبْنِيَ بِهَا وَلَمَّا يَبْنِي بِهَا. He said that, who is to join my army? He was addressing the people. So he said, a person who has gotten malaka budam ra'atin, means who owns the private of a part of a woman. In other words, he just got married. وَهُوَ يُرِيدُ أَن يَبْنِي بِهَا وَلَمَّا يَبْنِي بِهَا. He has just gotten married and he wants to cohabit with his wife, but he hasn't done so yet. That is what is being referred to. So what happens in this situation? This person should not follow me. In other words, not that there's anything wrong with the person, but he shouldn't come out in this jihad of ours. This is what Hadhrat Yusha alayhi salam said. What is the reason for this? I'll explain after we do the next portion. That is, وَلَمَّا يَبْنِي بِهَا, he hasn't yet cohabited with her. وَلَا أَحَدٌ بَنَا بُيُوتًا لَمْ يَرْفَعْ سُقُوفَهَا, no a person who has built houses and has not yet put on the roofs. ولا أحد اشترى غنما أو خليفات وهو ينتظر أولادها. No a person who has recently purchased a person who had purchased sheep أو خليفات. خليفات is a plural form of pregnant camels. He purchased pregnant sheep or pregnant camels, and he is waiting for the animal to give birth. So these type of people should not come out. What is the reason for this? The reason is because the person who has recently gotten married, he hasn't had a chance yet to be with his wife. That's the thing that's most on his mind. The person who's busy building a house is now finally reached the point, the walls are up, I just want to put the roof on for the house to be complete. But now it's like, the roof is not yet on. The place, you know, I'm almost done. I just need to do this. So his mind is on that. And the third person is the one who has these pregnant animals. He's just waiting now. You know, any moment now, the animal is going to give birth. You know, so he might be there, see that the animal comes out safely and everything of the sort like this here. So these people's, their minds are focused elsewhere. Their minds, and this is the how it comes together, is that these people, their mind is not on the jihad. Their mind is everywhere but the jihad. So in this situation, Hadhrat Yusha alayhi salam was saying, these people should stay at home. They should not come out in the jihad. Let those who are free and things, let them come out in the jihad. These other ones who's got other things on their mind, they should stay behind. We see many of these things, even if we look in the Sharia as well, where Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that, for example, a person who is needing to go to toilet, he should not perform salah until he has gone to the toilet. Because when a person needs to go to toilet, it overpowers a person's mind. You can't focus on your salah because it's like, I need to make finish five, I need to go to toilet. It goes like that. So your mind is focused on the toilet, even though you are in salah. So your focus is not on Allah and Salah, your focus is on the toilet that they need to rush to now. So therefore, you should not perform Salah, you should go to toilet, or if you're holding in a wind or anything of the sort, then you go and you relieve yourself, you make wudu, you come back and you perform your Salah. To clarify, with the example I gave here now of going to the toilet mentioned in the hadith. So what is meant by this? I'll just clarify, even though this is not a hadith that we are currently doing. But the point is that there is a person who, there are degrees, let me put it this way. A person needs to go to toilet, but I can hold on for another 45 minutes, that type of thing. That person, if he makes his salah in that state, it's not a problem. Why? Because even though, you know, I'm wanting to go to toilet, but it's not anything urgent. You know, I can forget about it even. There's that type of person. For this person, he did no harm if he makes his salah. The one that is being referred to is the one that needs to go right now, who's rushing to toilet, that type of person. It is not correct for him to perform salah until he has gone to toilet. So, and likewise, for example, if the food, you know, the food has just come, it's put on the table, you are hungry after a long day's work, now the Sharia says, eat first, then go make your salah. Not make salah and then come and eat. Why? Because now you're sending in salah, oh, samosas and pies, and your mind is on that, and it's not on your salah. So if you have eaten, then you go make your salah, then in that case, you now, Alhamdulillah, my stomach is filled. I am happy. I'm satisfied now. I can focus on my salah. That is what is being wanted here. So Hadhrat Yoosha alayhi salam was wanting that people should focus their minds on the jihad at hand and not to have their minds be wondering about everything else that is out there. So this is the first portion of the hadith. So, faghaza. When they went out in the jihad and when they came near to the town that they were supposed to now conquer, it was the time of Asr Salah or almost the time of Asr Salah. In other words, if they were to start a battle, we're not talking here now, you know, shoot a bullet and that's it. We're talking about battles which took hours, you know, armies coming up against each other, you know, those who shoot arrows, okay, this was in the early days. But anyway, so you've got your swords and things and you're going to clash on the battlefield now and, you know, all that sort of stuff, which is going to take a long time. So, فَقَالَ لِلشَّمْسِ Hazrat Yusha alayhi salam, he spoke to the sun. He said, إِنَّكِ مَأْمُورَةٌ وَأَنَا مَأْمُورٌ That you are commanded. You are under the command of Allah. وَأَنَا مَأْمُورٌ And I also have my commands from Allah. I am commanded by Allah to perform salah, and I'm also commanded by Allah to wage jihad against these people. So then he said, اللَّهُمَّ حَبِزْهَا عَلَيْنَا Oh Allah, hold the sun where it is for us. In other words, if we were to go now into the battle, by the time we are finished with the battle, we'll have mustered our Asr Salah. So Allah, oh Allah, keep the sun here as is so that we have enough time to complete the jihad, conquer the town, and then we can make still our Asr Salah. Because we were commanded to go straight and attack the town. That's what our commands are. So from Allah, so we have to do it. We don't have this way or that way. So فَحُبِسَتْ حَتَّى فَتَحَ اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ So Allah accepted his dua and Allah kept the sun where it was until Allah granted them victory and they conquered the town. Now, after everything, فَجَمَعَ الْغَنَائِمِ So they gathered all the booty. فجاءت يعني النار لتأكلها فلم تطعمها So when they had gathered all the booty together in one place, the meaning the fire, and this was the way that it was in the old days of Bani Israel and before, Allah used to send down a flame from the sky and it would burn up the booty. And that was a sign of it being accepted. When it came to the Qurbaani, for example, Allah would send down a fire, it would burn up the animal. That would be a sign of acceptance, things of that sort. So the fire came down, But he didn't burn up the booty. فَقَالَ إِنَّ فِيكُمْ غُلُولًا. So Hadhrat Yoosha alayhi salam, he turned to the people, he said, amongst you, there's a person who has stolen from the booty. فَلْيُبَايَعْنِي مِنْ كُلِّ قَبِيلَةٍ رَجُلٌ. From every tribe, where one person should come from each tribe and give me the bay'ah. In other words, put his hand in my hand. So, فَلَزِقَتْ يَرُ رَجُلٍ بِيَدِهِ. So, as each one of them came, they gave the bay'ah and they went on. And then one man came and he gave the bay'ah and his hand stuck to the hand of Hadhrat Yusha alayhi salam. فَقَالَ فِيكُمُ الْغُلُغُلُ. So Hadhrat Yusha alayhi salam said, in your tribe's people, that is where the thief is. فَلْتُبَايِعْنِي قَبِيلَتُكَ. Let your entire tribe, let each of them come and give me the bay'ah. فَلَزِقَتْ يَدُ رَجُلَيْنِ أَوْ ثَلَاثَةٍ بِيَدِهِ. So two or three people, their hands stuck to the hand of Hadhrat Yusha alayhi salam. فَقَالَ فِيكُمُ الْغُلُولُ. So Hadhrat Yusha alayhi salam told them, you are the ones, you have taken something from the booty. فَجَاءُوا بِرَأْسٍ مِثْلَ رَأْسِ بَقَرَةٍ مِنَ الذَّهَبِ. So they came with a head like the head of a cow, which was made out of gold. فَوَضَعَهَا. Then they put it amongst the rest of the booty. فَجَاءَتِ النَّارُ فَأَكَلَتْهَا. So the fire came down now from the sky and it burnt up everything. This was now shown that Allah has accepted it. This is all the booty. فَلَمْ تَحِلَّ الْغَنَائِمُ لِأَحَدٍ قَبْلَنَا. So Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that the booty from the war, from the jihad, it was not permissible for anyone before us. It is a speciality for this ummah that Allah has made it permissible to take war booty. Previously, the Anbiya alayhi salam and their people, they would defeat the people and then everything would have to be put in a place and burnt. Not, they don't burn it. Allah would send down a fire from the sky and it would immediately burn it up if it was accepted. And if it was not accepted, it would lay there. So, ثم أحل الله لنا الغنائم لما ترى ضعفنا فأحلها لنا. Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, thereafter Allah had permitted for us the booty after seeing our weakness. You know, we are in need of the money and stuff, and for as a perk for this ummah, Allah permitted taking the war booty permissible for us. It's two-sided, you know. From the one angle, it's a means of benefit, and from the second angle, it is a means of benefit. When a person looks at the situation in days of before, when a Nabi used to, or his people, were Bani Israel and them all, when they would, do a Qurbani, so to speak. And this applies in the situation when you have, for example, Habil and Qabil. They had to sacrifice something for the sake of Allah. And it carried on through the ages like that. Everybody had to sacrifice something. And if Allah had accepted it, a fire would come there in front of everybody and burn it up. And if the fire did not come down and burn it up, it means your sacrifice was rejected by Allah. Imagine if we were slaughtering today. Yeah, you see a person going for 500 sheep and he slaughters them and they just lay there and they rot. Allah did not send down the fire to burn it, meaning that Allah rejects all of this man's qurbani. Even if you were just doing one and Allah rejected, you know how you would look in society. That man, Allah rejected it. Imagine if this was the case, that Allah would expose us in front of everybody. Now here you come, and then people are like, but why did Allah reject yours? Something must be wrong with him. You know, did he steal the money maybe? You know, what was wrong that made it would be like that? You would be exposed as a wrongdoer in front of everybody. So it is from the bounties of Allah that Allah no longer does this for us. That not only does Allah not burn the animal up in this manner, but Allah in fact makes the meat permissible for us still to eat on top of it too. So the booty and the qurbani and things like this, it was not permissible for the previous nations to be able to make use of it, but Allah had permitted it for this ummah. He says, Al-Khalifatu bifath al-kha al-mu'jama wa kasr al-lam jam'u khalifatin wa hiya an-naqat al-hamil. The word khalifat, khalifatun, khalifatun, like kalimatun, kalimatun. It means, khalifatun means pregnant camels. And now we do the 59th hadith, the last hadith of this chapter, which is al-hadith al-sadisu an Abi Khalidin Hakim ibn Hizam radiyallahu anhu qala qala Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam al-bay'ani bil-khiyari ma lam yatafarraqa. Hadhrat Abu Khalid, his name was Hadhrat Hakim ibn Hizam radiyallahu anhu. He said that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Al-bayyani bil-khiyari ma lam yatafarraqa. That the buyer and the seller, the bayya'a, the two buyers, in other words, the buyer and the seller, both of them have the khiyar, the right of cancellation. Ma lam yatafarraqa, as long as they have not split up. Split up meaning the, when they've moved away from where they are together. In other words, let's put it this way. You come to a friend of yours, you say, hey, you know what, I'm going to buy this car of yours. How much is it? It's 10,000 rand. Okay, I'm taking it. Yeah, sure. Okay, good. Done. Finish. End of story. We done deal. Now you sit and you chat. Four or five hours go by while you catching up with old times and everything like this. Yeah. Now it's like, yeah, you know what? Looking at this car now, man, I don't really want it. No. Then the friend comes, no. You already agreed to it. You can't cancel. But the Sharia says, ma lam yatafarraqa. They haven't separated yet. It's not like they agreed on it and they went their own ways. I'm going to go and draw money, you know. I'll be back tomorrow when I've got all the money for you. Now you've separated. The deal is done. It's cemented. Now you can come in and ask to have to cancel the sale, you know, the iqala and all those sort of stuff. That rulings come in. But that right of breaking it, without consequences, that has fallen away because now the transaction has been cemented. Ma lam yatafarraqa. So even though hours have gone by while you were chatting there, but you had not yet separated. So therefore, the transaction had not yet gotten cemented. In fact, it says, Al-bayya'ani, both of them, the buyer and the seller. The buyer can turn around and say, no, you know what, I don't want to buy it. The seller can say, no, you know what, I think I'm going to need my car myself for a bit longer. I know I'm doing this. I'm not going to be selling it. Now you can't say, but you just told me you're selling it to me. You can't turn around now. But the Sharia says, ma lam yatafarraqa. You haven't separated. So it's my right to now say, you know, I don't want to sell it. Or I decide, no, man, I put the price a little bit low. I'll put the price up. I'll make it 40,000 and put it up later on again. I want to cancel the transaction here now. So you have that right at this time. ما لم يتفرقا. Then فإن صدقا وبينا بورك لهما في بيعهما. النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم said فإن صدقا, if they both tell the truth, وبينا and clarify matters, بورك لهما في بيعهما, then Allah will put baraka in their transaction. وإن كذبا وكتما محقت بركة بيعهما. But if they lie and they conceal, then the barakah or the barakah of their transaction will be removed. It will be destroyed and erased, so to speak. Muttafaqun alayh. This hadith is agreed upon both by Imam Bukhari and Imam Muslim, rahimahum Allah, its authenticity. So what is the next part? Fa'in sadaqa wa bayyana. And when you are in business and you actually do business, you tend to see why Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam spoke about at-tajiru saduqul amin, the truthful, uprighteous shopkeeper, businessman, why he'll be with the anbiya like that in Jannah on account of being a truthful businessman. Because it sounds simple, but a lot of the time people fall short in it. فَإِن صَدَقَى. So both of them tell the truth. وَبَيَّنَا. And they explain. So Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam added two parts to it. Telling the truth and explaining. So now you see what happens is sometimes people come and it's like, I'm selling a car. The car got a fault. I know there's a fault in it. So the man asked me, how's the engine? Oh, the engine's tip top. And shocks. Oh, shocks are good. You know, and this, oh, that's all fine. So I told the truth because he didn't ask me about the gearbox. The gearbox is faulty. I know that it slips out of gear the whole time, but he didn't ask me about the gearbox because he probably assumed, you know, it's not such a common problem. So he didn't think to ask about it. I didn't lie, but you didn't explain it. You needed to explain the faults with it. Then then Allah will put barakah in it. But now you told the truth, but you concealed. So wakatama, this is the dual form. So here in this case, you concealed the fact that there was a fault in it. So in this case, you will be liable and the barakah will be removed on account of it. Now, there are a lot of fiqh in this hadith itself. You know, you can speak for a day just on the fiqh derived from this hadith. But just to touch on one point, which is that in business, if, for example, you are selling let's say, for example, a car, does it mean you must go with a pen and paper and look, okay, there's a little bit of a scratch here. Here the stitching is coming loose. Here this, you know, and write down everything point for point like this here so that you can give the person 99 points that's a false with the car. The person can't even see half of it himself. He wouldn't even notice it. But are you required to do that? Not necessarily. There is certain things which is regarded as if you're selling secondhand stuff, there's a certain degree which is understood as being regular wear and tear. So the seats are a bit off color. A person understands. You don't have to tell him, you know, the seats are off color over here. If you do, all the better. But I mean, that's not what is required. If you're selling a new item, and there's a fault in it, then you must say, even though this car is new, but you can see here, there's a, and this is what you call factory rejects, for example. In a business today, there's a type of item which is known as a factory reject. So it's new, but there's a stain, for example, maybe where, you know, something was laying on top of it, or some water came through and damaged it, or there's, you know, something left some mark on it, or some stitching was not right. So the factory don't sell it, they give it to other people, and those people sell it as factory rejects. So when you're selling things of this nature, now you explain, there's this problem, there's that problem, you explain it. So new items, you got to point out if there's a flaw and a fault in it. If it's secondhand items and things which are understood in society, everybody understands that the car is not going to shine like a bottle top. And the tires are not going to be have the full thread like a brand new car. So even though it is deemed as being somewhat of a deficiency, but it is normal, natural wear and tear, and people understand this. So this is not what is required. This is point number one. Another point in this regard is that, for example, you're selling a car. The person who comes to buy for the car from you is a person who himself is into buying, selling, and repairing of cars. So you tell him, look, I'm not going to tell you anything about the car. I leave it entirely up to you. You check the car out and then, you know, you must check everything and then tell me when you are satisfied, what if you want to buy it, still, and everything of the sort. So he goes with his, if he's a mechanic or he brings his mechanic with him and they check the car out, look top, bottom, take it for a ride and everything. And they say, yeah, okay, I want it. You know, in this case here, even though you did not point out the flaws, the ulama have stated in this situation here, because you put it totally in his hands and he had agreed to it and he had checked it out, the fact that he did not pick up the problem, that would not be an issue. Yes, where there will be an issue though, is when there's a serious issue, but it's not noticeable at first. And I don't know how true this is, but people say, for example, if you have a problem with your engine and you throw sugar in the petrol tank, then it will make the car sound and ride smoothly for a short while, and then it will cause a problem. You know, you'll have big air problems down the line. So now, maybe I'm misunderstanding it, maybe it's not even true at all, but anyway, so what I'm trying to use this example to point out is that you have put a means of deception in, or there's something that only happens when you ride about 100 kilometers, then the car suddenly cuts out and they don't want to start no more. You don't know what the issue is. Now, he would be riding around the corner, so he sees, okay, yeah, no, everything seems normal. He doesn't know the minute he rides and he hits 100 kilometers, it's suddenly going to break down. Now, if he knew it, he would probably say, no, man, this is a big problem. You know, I can't pay this sort of money. But you concealed it. So at the end of the day, what is important to note is that there must be no evil and no concealing of problems and things of this nature. And on the flip side of the coin, we understand all of this is coming from the seller side. But what about from the buyer? How does the buyer fit into this whole thing? Well, how does he come in sadaqa wa bayyana or kadaba wa katama and things of this sort? This is also quite common. You are selling for example, you're selling a car for 40,000 rand. And the man comes to you, you know, give me a better price. You know, things are so difficult. Oh, you know, I can't really afford it right now. Can't you give me a better price? And he was like, okay, let's make it 30,000, you know, because you're saying things are difficult, I'll give it to you at 30. They're like, oh, you know what? I just only have 30,000. I'll take it, you know. Oh, I wish it could have come but cheaper, but I'll take it for 30. And you'll come across this amongst people in business. So this person has lied. He don't only have 30,000, but he lies, making himself seem, he plays poverty and things like this, so you can drop the price, give him a better price and everything like this. But in reality, he has lied. So this year, from his side, will also negate the barakah of the transaction. So that is why it comes from both sides. The buyer and the seller, both have to be truthful. Both have to point out and be realistic and, uprighteous about everything. Then there will be barakah in the transaction. So when you look at it, in reality, even though not everything is all doom and gloom, there is a degree which the Sharia gives leeway in. Like I said, the normal wear and tear, you don't literally have to go and make a checkbox and write all of that down. But if you do it, it's all the better. If you look, I've noticed when I was looking once upon a time at a second-hand, this one particular website that sells cars, but they buy and sell cars. And they take it to one of these roadworthy centers who do a full check on the car. And then they give you a printout of what exactly are the faults they find on the car. Now, they don't go over it with a fine-tooth comb, but they will say, for example, little scratch here, little dink here. If you look at the car from the outside, you may not even notice that scratch or that dink. But when you come close up, you see, oh, this is a scratch. This is a dink they pointed out. So, you know, that type of thing would be more in line with what you would be going at. So, you know, I know that I have this issue. I know that there's a rust bubble by the window. So when it rains, it's going to come in. I know this year, this. So you point these things out, you know, at the end of the day. And this is where the issue comes in. You're going to come and point it out to somebody. You say, this problem. I got my car here. So I know the engine is problematic. I know my shocks are problematic. I know I don't have door handles on the car. There's this year, the computer box and this and things. And then the person is like, oh, you know, that amount of problems. Oh, no, I can't buy this. So half the buyers will be turned away on account of you laying out the problems. The point is, keep your faith in Allah and Allah will make a way out for you. But if you conceal it, you'll get the car sold in no time. You'll say, hey, you know what? This car is, yo, you're getting a bargain over here. There's no problems with this car. It needs a little bit of TLC, you know? That's about all. So you concealing the faults, you're not exactly lying about anything, but you're not clarifying and pointing things out. So the person comes and he buys the car and things like this here. So you sell it, but it's devoid of barakah. So when you want things to be fully with barakah, being that tajiru saduq al-ameen that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam speaks about, then you need to put all of these things into play and you're like, okay, look, even though it may take me longer, even though my price may end up coming lower, at the end of the day, if I keep my faith in Allah and I do things the right way, then even if I get less money, Allah will put more barakah in that money. So that's how we should be looking at things. And yes, it is difficult. You are in need of the money and you're struggling and you need to sell something quickly and things like this. And then people still take advantage of you. And they're like, you wanting 40,000 and you'd be like, I'll give you 15. People are that way as well. And that type of person, he'll also be taken to task by Allah for that. And he'll have no barakah in that car, which he gets from you for 15,000. So at the end of the day, the point is, and this is how the hadith relates to the chapter, being truthful. Sadaqah. Both has to be truthful in the buying and the buyer and the seller. And in doing so, Allah will make it a means of barakah. And that's the end of the hadith, the fifth hadith, and the end of our 59th hadith, and the end of our chapter of Siddiq as well. And we will stop on this point here, inshallah. We won't start Bab al-Muraqabah. We'll end on the end of this chapter. And like I said yesterday, we are ending classes on Thursday because of the likelihood of Dhul Hijjah beginning. In fact, regardless of which, Monday would be Dhul Hijjah already. So therefore, our classes will end now until after the Ayyam al-Tashriq, which I will say when exactly we'll resume at the later stage, inshallah ta'ala, like I normally mention on WhatsApp. But for now, we will end here. Until next time, wa sallallahu wa sallama wa baraka ala nabiyyina Muhammad, subhanallahi wa bihamdihi, subhanakallahumma wa bihamdik, nashhadu an la ilaha illa anta, nastaghfiruka wa natubu ilayk. Wassalamu alaykum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.